גבירותיי ורבותיי, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the public lecture, which is part of a Humboldt colleague on the subject of 19th century Germans as scholars in humanities. The event has been organized by the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation and co-sponsored by Fritz Thyssen Foundation, the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and of course, the Van Leer Jerusalem Institute, at the premises of which this lecture tonight takes place. Our distinguished speaker is Professor Ottmar Ette, and before I pass the floor to him, I would like briefly to introduce him. Professor Ette is chair of Romance Literature and Comparative Literature at the University of Potsdam in Germany. As a young scholar, he wrote dissertation at Freiburg University on the poet José Martí, and his habilitation at Eichstätt University on the French theorist Roland Barthes. From 1995, he teaches at University of Potsdam. He has broad interests and research on many topics, of which the main are Alexander von Humboldt, trans-area studies about the movement of literature, especially Spanish language and French language literature, inside and outside of Europe, literary studies as science of life, and other. Since 2014, he is the head of the research project Alexander von Humboldt's Amerikanische Reisetagebücher, American Travel Diaries of Alexander von Humboldt. And since 2015, he's in charge of the Traveling Humboldt Science on the Move project, which focuses on editing the manuscripts of Alexander von Humboldt's American and Russian Siberian travel diaries. He published numerous monographs, edited books, and journal articles, of which I can mention some, for example, Literature on the Move, Trans-Area, eine literarische Globalisierungsgeschichte, Alexander von Humboldt und die Globalisierung. And his most recent book appeared last May, and it's called The Fall Jauss, Wege des Verstehens in eine Zukunft der Philologie, which means the case of Jauss, ways of understanding towards a future of philology. It deals with the leading German post-war Romanist Hans Robert Jauss, whose personality is a matter of controversy because of his past service in SS during the National Socialist period. And this will not be the topic of today's lecture, but the topic of tomorrow's lecture just nearby at the Israeli Academy of Sciences. You're very welcome to attend. The lecture will start tomorrow at 6 p.m. Today's subject is different and related to the long, lifelong interests of Professor Ette in Humboldt, Alexander von Humboldt, and literature on the move. He will speak today on the German scholars of humanities on the move, Alexander von Humboldt and Adelbert von Chamisso. Professor Ette.
Thank you so much. So many things on the move, so I will be on the move as well for this conference tonight. Thank you very much, Efraim, for this very kind introduction. And my first thoughts go to all the organizers, all the institutions that made possible this wonderful conference and allowed me to come here. I'm very happy to be here in Israel. And it's for me a great pleasure and an honor to be here. And as Roland Barthes said, l'honneur peut être immérité, la joie ne l'est jamais. So I'm really, it's really a great pleasure for me. I came here to listen. I came to Israel to listen. And this is perhaps the point where the organizers get nervous, because they did not invite me to listen. But I think this is always a very important dimension of what we are doing, listening as well. And in that sense, I want to know more about the points of view you have in Israel, and I've learned a lot today already, but there's so much more to learn. So I just try to interrupt my listening for 40 minutes this tonight, and I would like to to stress perhaps that point, because it's already part in a way of the lecture, in the sense that listening is a very specific quality in the case of the travelers I will address tonight. So one of the beautiful anecdotes, se non è vero e ben trovato, of the around Alexander von Humboldt, and there are many, many apocryph anecdotes, is that somebody in the Andean region and Indio, indigenous person, talking very badly about Alexander von Humboldt. And he said, "This is the most stupid man I've ever seen in my life time. He is not stopping. He's doing, he's asking questions all the time. This man knows nothing." So we have the travelogues by Alexander von Humboldt, and now we know all the conversations he had and he wrote down, and there are so many things he learned through listening. And so I think this is a very specific quality that is perhaps sometimes forgotten or skipped. So I will listen to you after this conference, after the 40 minutes, and the conference may start. Everything is moving. All these people that have nothing to do in Europe are just running around all over the place and all over the world, publishing new travelogues. But what do we really know about humanity? In 1775, Herder, in this too, a philosophy of history for the formation of humanity, addresses what's happening around him. And what's happening at the very start of the long 19th century then is a period of accelerated globalization. It has been theorized perhaps for the first time by Alexander von Humboldt. But Herder in 1774 can directly see the changes and the transformations of all these, of the impact of the acceleration at a global level. And the power and all that that has been later addressed by the distribution of violence on the globe during the 6 years between 1492 and 1498. So travelers from Europe in this second period of accelerated globalizations brought new informations, bringing to an end, as Wolf Lepenies has stated, the Naturgeschichte, so the natural science, by the amount of new informations that had to be processed in a different way, with different epistemic foundations. One of these forerunners of the science on the move is certainly in the German context, Georg Forster. Georg Forster, born in 1754, died in 1794, and he, in his travel around the world, published first in English and later in German as Reise die Welt, one of these key figures that not only speak different languages, but publish in different languages and are kind of translingual travelers and writers at the same time, and this is important for my topic. He addresses the changes that started with the Berlin debate on the New World, where Cornelius de Pau and his Recherche philosophique sur les Américains, and the Americans at that moment were the indigenous people, or Guillaume Thomas Reynal with his Histoire des deux Indes intervened. And Georg Forster addresses this as the système philosophique, as the philosophical systems that control the knowledge. And he's talking about the shift that he had acknowledged in the context of the collection of new facts, and not alternative facts, new facts all around the world. And the problem addressed by Wolf Lepen is to process all these facts. So he sees two, Georg Forster sees two different developments. On one hand, so the system philosophique that is imposing its own right by people who do not travel, and on the other hand, the travelers that just collect new facts without bringing them together. This is what Georg Forster calls the Fliegenbeinzählerei, so counting the little legs of the flies without seeing the whole thing. But this is what Georg Forster was after. Georg Forster tried to bring together all these facts in the Reise the Welt as in a hermeneutic circle, bringing together a new vision or developing a new vision and opening, so in that sense, a new period for German humanities on the move. In that context, it is very interesting to see that he at the same time sees as a kind of post-history. In a text published in 1791, he sees how the whole history is dissolving in commerce, how everything in history comes to an end and is, in a way, dissolved into a relational model without any history. Now, Roland Barthes, and I will not stress this point, has pointed out that with Jules Michelet and others, the theme for a post-historical dimension or vision of history is there from the very start of modernity. But what matters for me today is, in that sense, see the different issues in a moment when the utopia created in 1516 by Thomas More, looking at the Caribbean, at what today is the Isla de Juventud, was at the end of the 18th century replaced by Uchronia. So, not in projections, not in the space. The globe was well known at that moment, at the end of the 18th century, but with l'an 2440 by Sébastien Mercier, an uchronical dimension. So my topic is not about utopia. My topic is not about uchronia. My topic is about vectopia. So the projection not in space, the projection not in time only, but the projection on the move. And Georg Forster did not only try to address global dimensions in his travel around the world, but in his travel, together with young Alexander von Humboldt in 1790, to the Reise zum Ansichten vom Niederrhein. So, and these titles will form the two men who will stand in the center of my talk tonight. So Alexander von Humboldt and Adelbert von Chamisso. With these, in these contexts, so we are not dealing with an atopic, utopic, heterotopic dimension, but in stressing the dimension of the move. We are entering a new world, he states in the chapter 25 in his Ansichten vom Niederrhein, when going from Den Haag to Amsterdam. And Amsterdam is not just a place, it's a place in time and on the move. He starts his picture in the harbor, and there he first tries to explain how this harbor was built, where the warships are, what kind of equipment and weapons they do have, and then the commercial part of the harbor. Amsterdam is not a place. It's the crisscrossing of different movements. It's a whole world and a new world. So in that sense, of course, space and time are there, but they are built upon the dimension of movement. And of course, his own lifestyle was pretty close to this again. So in his traveling through the Ansichten vom Niederrhein in 1790, he will go, and this, as far as I see, the forester industry has not been addressed until now. He's going to three global players at that moment: the Dutch, the Brits, and the French. Not reaching, in a sense, the French Revolution he is always addressing. In this context, of course, he is discussing globalization, but this time not in a travel around the world, but just in a travel, in a very local or regional travel around the Dutch, the British, and the French territories. So in this sense, it's absolutely interesting how he builds in a trans-aerial understanding of a given place. So you could say in a local way, but the importance is that he is basing his dimension, his understanding of the world on that kind of move and acceleration. And so Georg Forster opens the door to what will become kind of mobile science in the 19th century. And my two examples here are Alexander von Humboldt and Adelbert von Chamisso. Alexander von Humboldt, as we know, born in 1769 and a member of the Academy, as well as the other two, the Berlin Academy of Sciences, is addressing in his autobiographic sketch from 1806, his traveling with Georg Forster. He opened a world for me. And for the first time, I've seen the sea, the ocean, the mobile element, he will call later. The mobile element that allowed him to travel around. Ich hatte ferne Sehnsüchte. I had a desire for far away countries, for traveling. It is not specified. He had very different plans, going to Mecca, going to the Atlas, to Morocco. He wanted to go to the Americas, but Asia, of course, was an issue as well. What he wanted was to leave Europe and to understand, in that sense, better his own Europeanness. When he leaves the shores of Europe, he addresses it as not as Spain, the last lights when he is in June 1799, when he's leaving the Spanish port of La Coruña. He's addressing that from a European way. So this doesn't mean a Eurocentric dimension, but a consciousness about this kind of knowledge based upon the move. The transdisciplinary, crossing different disciplines, the transareal, crossing different cultural areas, and of course the transmedial dimensions of his writing are well known today. But what seems for me very important in that sense is how we can understand the epistemology of movement in this context. Already in Georg Forster, there was a deep link between motion and emotion, between a physical movedness, motion, and the inner motion and the senses he addresses continually. And he's testing his senses. Alexander von Humboldt is very, very precise when seeing if 6 hours of direct insulation make him change, produce changes in his kind of reflection. And he tries to go up to 12 hours of direct insulation to see what happens. He will climb the mountains and note exactly what happens with his own body. So the body will be one of the companions of Alexander von Humboldt. They are the instrumental reason, the instruments he's taking with him, presenting them as fellow travelers from the very start, trying to establish a kind of global isoterms and ISO understanding, so a given level to relate to in very different ways and very different disciplines, temperature, magnetic fields, but also cultural dimensions. And at the same time, he develops a relational, a multi-perspective understanding of what he is doing. We cannot understand, and this is a typically Humboldtian, and I would say in the double sense, Wilhelm as well as Alexander, we cannot understand the world from the point of view of one single language. And there is no such thing that we can understand the world just looking from the top of a mountain, even if you're right on top of the Chimborazo. As we know, he never reached the Chimborazo, and he was very fond of it, very proud of it. So the Chimborazo became the symbol of his own traveling, never reaching the end, always on the move. In this sense, he tried to configure a world that is not based upon the otherness. And this is something I feel, as we address in the whole Congress, this question, what can 19th century humanities give us today, and in which sense can we translate them today? So this seems a very important point. In the Berlin debate, the otherness of the American world was given for granted. So the others were the indigenous people. And in terms of Zvitan Todorov, you only have the choice between talking about a superiority or an inferiority, if you consider the otherness. In this sense, perhaps, after such a long time addressing le même et l'autre, so the same and the other, and this is the title of Vincent Descombes' study on French philosophy of the 20th century, everything around the otherness, we can see, and it starts with Georg Forster, how this otherness becomes precarious. How we can see other concepts popping up that are not related to construct the other as kind of opposite, as a kind of somebody we can establish a dialogue with, but then always stays on the other side of the table. A little bit in that situation we are right now. So in that sense, but the good thing in this context is that we change roles. the bad thing in Dolorov's analysis of la question de l'autre in the conquest of the Americas is that we do not change the place. This is something I feel that is extremely important. So Humboldt tries to establish a dimension that goes beyond weiter and not the other that we are in front of. Of course, Alexander von Humboldt is a natural scientist, and he is at the same time a cultural scientist. And so in the field, what he does in the field of natural sciences, and nature and culture are not easily distinguishable for him, as for Forster already. When Forster is describing the harbor of Amsterdam, he makes no difference between the wind and the sailing ships, between the masts and the trees. All of these elements are there, the masts on the ships and the trees under the arsenal, under the building in the swamps of Amsterdam. And Humboldt is adapting the epistemics of natural science to cultural science and vice versa. For him, this difference would not be convincing. And so I just take it as a kind of scientific myth we know since the 50s by Charles Percy Snow and the two cultures. Here we go a little bit back in order to understand better perhaps the future in a period where the Anthropocene is there and where from the 1950s on, even in geography, such a thing as natural landscape doesn't exist anymore. The human being is there in every part of nature. So, and of course we know that there are cultures that do not distinguish between culture and nature. So, of course, in botanics, for example, it would not make sense to construct a difference between the others and us. There are differences that go weiter. You have kind of expansion and a kind of widening, broadening your own conception of the world, not in terms of opposites, but in terms of enrichment. Enrichment in the sense of trying to bring together new facts in order to integrate them into a complex understanding of the phenomena of our times. And the more facts I gather, the more it is possible to understand the complexity of a relational dimension. Already with Amsterdam, in Georg Forster, the difference between Den Haag and Amsterdam is that one of these spots is a global island, so to speak. It is relational, like in an archipelago. It has its own logic, so it's an island world, but at the same time it is interrelated with other places, other arbors, other logics, other islands in a trans-archipelagic way. So it's not only an island world, but a world of islands at the same time. And this is what Alexander von Humboldt develops, a different logic that goes beyond the otherness of the other, the construction of others. And in the field of what we would call today cultural studies. Of course, there's another dimension as well of this kind of weiter, this kind of continuing, of broadening, of widening the understanding. And this is something that goes as well beyond our own life. In Humboldt's sense, the Chimborazo represents the never-ending story of a kind of climbing. There is, of course, a certain phase in progress. And the myth of progress is very close to the Humboldtian sense in terms of Alexander. At the same time, we can see that this goes beyond an individual life. So the Weiterleben, the continuing to live, is not only the question of the space, as we have seen at the very start. So the ocean opening up a whole world in order to allow him as an individual to widen up the horizons he knows. And of course, horizon is a vectorial metaphor. When you move, your horizon changes. But not only widening in that sense in space, but also in time. So in a kind of rethinking his own life in terms of scientific fulfillment that never comes to a final stop. Of course, this may sound trivial because we all know that we are working in fields where others, younger, better ones, will continue. But in Humboldt, it has become a very interesting field of reflection. Not only in the different phantasmagoric dimensions that are very visible in his American travelogues and in his manuscripts. There are so many parts of in his manuscripts you can see when he starts talking about his own death. The phantasmagoric dimension, or le fantasme plutôt, this dimension is very present in his kind of adventures he gives us. When, for example, the ship, there's a when the ship is going down, and the whole expedition falls into the water with the piranhas ride at the Orinoco, or when on the 26th of May in 1802 in what today is Ecuador, he's climbing the Ruku Pichincha. And when he all of a sudden gets aware of the fact that a snow bridge, that they are crossing a snow bridge over a part of the volcano. So the phantasm of Alexander von Humboldt is to disappear without leaving any traces, falling into the volcano and just disappearing. Of course, writing and the obsession of writing and the thousands of pages he's producing is something that is immediately and directly linked to the will to survive. But not only to survive in a very specific dimension, so kind of survival knowledge, and he is quite good in that, but going beyond in a kind of Weiterleben, so a continuing to live through his own writing. So what will not disappear in Humboldt is the writing, and it's very clear on that point. When the group, his expedition, is climbing La Cuchilla del Chimborazo, so a part where you have rocks coming out of the snow, he is addressing this topic when he says that all the members of the group try to climb this way with a certain tendency towards the right side. Why? On the left-hand side, they would have fallen into the snow and the ice, and they would just have disappeared from the surface of the world. On the other side, they would have fallen onto the rocks. They would have been killed as well, but the writings would have survived. So he would not have disappeared just without leaving any traces. And in that sense, it is very important to understand that in the inscription of in what he is doing every night during hours, sleeping very, very little, is trying to create the possibility of surviving by writing, going beyond what is given in space and time to a human being. So in that very specific dimension, and this is dedicated to my son, There is a dimension of not only surviving, but to produce something that goes beyond the life of a single individual. So climbing on the Chimborazo side is in that sense epistemic, because it is not limited to a given moment in time and space. It brings together motion and emotion, the crossing of the mountain of Chimborazo, from where he is looking, not from the top, but it was a world record in climbing he established at that moment, at a moment when Chimborazo was thought to be the highest mountain in the world. He is not addressing a kind of point from where we can see the world, or the whole world. He's lacking this kind of experience, and he's marking that very clearly. So if we are not able to understand the world from a single point of linguistic view, he is addressing the same time in space as well. If you have a look at the travelogues, they change continually the languages. Humboldt is writing mainly in French and in German. He's bringing in a lot of Latin in the descriptions, but also in other dimensions, in kind of Bildung. He is bringing in Incaic languages, and there's a deep link Jürgen has worked upon in the sense of a co-production between the Humboldt brothers, we could say. And there is, of course, the need to stress the dimension of never arriving, of never fulfilling, of something that always lacks. So if there is something that always lacks, we can continue walking. We can continue to do research. And this is so never arriving at a given point. Here is, I feel, something that is opening, a very important opening towards the differences and the respect for differences in different cultures, languages, and so forth. He is not dealing with the superiority of one language over another. German is not more important to him than French, and French is not able to express everything he wants to express. And he is continually changing languages, including English as well, for example. So, and it must have been some kind of English as I use, if you've heard, that it's not a perfect English, but he did. He spoke very quickly, as many have stated. So Alexander von Humboldt developed that kind of picture where you have a continuous non-production of otherness. So there is no such kind of a clear superiority. Of course, in the long run, we can see how he started and had to free himself from these conceptions by the philosophical systems he is addressing in 1813 as a révolution heureuse, as a happy revolution. A revolution, of course, that comes after the industrialization and the political revolution of the French Revolution, but he is aware of something we have forgotten for quite a long time, that there are two American revolutions as well, the one in the North and the one in the Caribbean, the Haitian Revolution. He's very aware of that fact. In that kind of transformation, we see an opening, and it's very interesting to see in which sense this is present in another traveler, so Adelbert von Chamisso. We should perhaps not forget the fact that Georg Forster and Adelbert von Chamisso together have lived less years of as writers as Humboldt did in a very long life. publishing for more than 70 years. Adelbert von Chamisso, as Georg Forster, whose Parisische Umrisse is the last, his last word on the French Revolution, crying against the German reaction and saying, unsere Karte ist Paris. So the victory will be ours. The French Revolution is a very important point for him. And for Alexander von Humboldt, it is exactly the same situation. He is addressing, when going with Georg Forster to Paris, he's addressing the moment when he carries and he tries to help to build the Temple of Liberty. In case of Adelbert von Chamisso, coming from an aristocratic family, he had to leave France at the moment of the French Revolution when he was 11 years old. Again, this is somebody crossing different languages and writing in different languages, mainly in German, but not only. And there's a German where you can see the words under the words. So the language under the language, a translingual writing that he develops during his lifetime. In 1810, during a stay in Paris, he is addressing the presence of Alexander von Humboldt. So Adelbert von Chamisso wrote at that moment in 1810, he is continually changing houses. He is living at least in three houses at the same time, and he, during the night time, he's sleeping at the observatoire. So it's continually on the move, and Adelbert von Chamisso is fascinated because he is suffering from the loss of movement. He feels like a Protestant, like a Catholic among Protestants in Prussia, and like a Protestant among Catholics in France. He feels like somebody who is a Frenchman in Prussia and a Prussian in France. He feels like an aristocratic person among Democrats and like a Democrat among aristocratic persons. So the fascination for Humboldt is something that will change his, not only his lifestyle, but also his understanding of the world, trying to develop his own vectopical dimension. So the moment we have seen Adelbert von Chamisso is in 1810, and in 1812, he starts a new career. He inscribes himself in the new founded, Humboldtianally founded Berlin University. And he writes one of perhaps the most beautiful accounts of the second period of accelerated globalization, which is his famous Peter Schlemihl, with the 7 mile boots on, and where you can go everywhere on the surface of the planet. You can displace yourself, but this is not happiness. He is addressing this dimension of a quasi-ubiquity at a planetary level, and he is addressing the second period of accelerated globalization. It is quite interesting to see that one of the great theorists of the third period of accelerated globalization in the last 30 years, 28 years of the 19th century, perhaps up to the start of the Second World War, José Martí, he takes the 7 mile miles boots from Adelbert von Chamisso to make us understand how an acceleration of globalization is working. He immediately detected that dimension, but it took a very long time to understand this in a historical context. So the dream of Adelbert von Chamisso comes true in 1850, when he is able to join the Russian expedition under the command of Otto von Kotzebue with the Russian brick Rurik, in a traveling round the world. There's a kind of late coming of the Russians in that sense, that they start something, the powers in place, the British and the French did earlier, almost three decades earlier. But this is the chance for Adelbert von Chamisso to inscribe himself in this kind of Reise die Welt. And he takes the title of Georg Forster, and the second part is called Ansichten, so like the other title of Georg Forster. There's a great continuity in Adelbert von Chamisso's thought, and I would say if we started a little bit the 19th century a little bit earlier, in 1774, we could perhaps in the German context end it a little bit earlier. So the colonial dimension in German history had faded away in around 1740, the moment when Frederick II, or the Great, comes to power. Only a couple of months before was eliminated the Brandenburg African-American Company. It was a complete disaster, even if they had a wonderful ship called the Kurfürst von Brandenburg, which had been kidnapped from the Brandenburg pirates from the Spanish fleet. It was the Carolus Magnus of the... But it was a complete disaster, and only in the after the late coming of the foundation of the German Reich, then the colonial expansion of Germany took place again. And there the things change. Forster, Humboldt, and Chamisso are still part of the production of a understanding of the world in its globalized dimensions and in its not reducible to, reducible structure to otherness that comes to an end in travel literature in the German context with the colonial adventure and the colonial disasters that were up to come. So this is for me the very important point in that kind of conceptions that are so much needed, I feel, in our times. Not reducing the world to territories, not reducing it to othernesses, not reducing everything to a dialogue between us and the others, but to a complex intertwining of a polylogical structure that is already there. It's very interesting. In a philosopher that has been forgotten in German history, it's the first black philosopher, Anton Wilhelm Amor, in the first half of the 18th century. A long forgotten figure of a philosopher that is badly needed in order to see other traditions in German history, mobile traditions. So, in Adelbert von Chamisso, we see in which sense the lifestyle and the autobiographical dimension is embedded in a travel literature that is continually referring not to others, but to more and more people. He is not centered by a single language. When at Tenerife he arrives and he is asked if he could perhaps sing a Russian melody or something like that, he says that he is a Russian, but not really a Russian. Perhaps more a German, but not really a German. No, perhaps a French, but not really a French. So it's not an essential essential definition of his own understanding of the world. He's continually on the move. When he describes the nutshell of the brick Rurik, he's continually addressing it as a microcosm related to the macrocosm. And when he addresses his friendships to people he knows during his travel, And for example, an indigenous person in the southern Pacific, Kadu, he's talking in terms about him, not in terms of a savage or a non-civilized person. He would never think in these terms, but of the person he came closest to him during all his lifetime, a true friendship. Marking the differences, he does not reduce it to otherness. Claiming the respect for the difference, he's addressing the possibility and the necessity of conviviality, how we can live together in peace and harmony. At the same time, he's sure that with all his readings, there's only life that teaches life. Nur Leben lernt Leben. And embedded in that change of world consciousness, something, a term created by Alexander von Humboldt or recreated, a little bit like world literature by Goethe, Weltbewußtsein, world consciousness by Alexander von Humboldt. Adelbert von Chamisso is addressing this kind of rethinking its own moving position between different languages, between different cultures in a relational way. So he states that at the first, like in the book, in his own life, he's always opening a new chapter. And at the very start of the chapter, he should have known better, but he will only be aware of at the end of the chapter. So at the end of this chapter, and at the end of his own traveling, Adelbert von Chamisso's traveling, we see a last chapter opening where he addresses his own death and how all this could continue. And he addresses the fact that even his last chapter is something where only in his bed of my agony I will perhaps have access to that kind of wisdom I was always looking for. The concept of wisdom goes beyond science. It is not a disciplinary dimension of what we can know about ourselves and the world. The concept of wisdom in Adelbert von Chamisso, in this sense, is something that is opening up towards a world of conviviality and respect for difference on a global level. Or we could say, in that sense, that beyond the disciplinary knowledge, there's something else we can and we should address as scientists and in the field of humanities at a global level. I started with Roland Barthes, and I will end with Roland Barthes at the very end of his leçon, his lesson, when he was elected to the Collège de France, when he tried to define what sapientia is. Nul pouvoir, un peu de savoir, un peu de sagesse, et le plus de saveur possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ette, for your fascinating lecture. And now we have a little time for a couple of questions, so I'll collect them from the audience, and then Professor Ette will respond. Yes.
I see three hands, so three questions. Please pass to Daniel, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a fascinating and stimulating talk, really. In the book, which you've mentioned by Todorov, La Conquête de l'Amérique, Todorov remarks that the superiority of the Americans over the indigenous in what would become Latin America was in the type of behavior and type of knowledge of the European powers of Cortez. which he defines as a kind of improvisation. He uses this word, improvisation. Improvisation stands in contrast with the more ritualized and strict type of knowledge of the indigenous population. This is allows Cortes and the rest of the conquistadors to adapt and to react much more spontaneously and much more effectively to the new challenges which were posed by the new conditions. Now, this improvisation also has, of course, underlying epistemic variables which support it, a type of openness to unpredictability and so on and so forth. So, and what you, the way that you describe Humboldt is in fact, seems to me as a knowledge which fits into this type of improvisation, like the life which only which teaches life and so on and so forth, a type of very spontaneous and vital knowledge. So perhaps we could elaborate a little bit on this.
Okay.
Two more questions. Just a second.
Thank you very much. It was an inspiring world tour, and I always thought of Alexander von Humboldt as somebody anticipating the idea of Feldarbeit, of going to the field, of Feldarbeit, of doing like field work, as like Bronislaw Malinowski was mentioned today. However, after your talk, I think that maybe this is a wrong conception, because of, the idea of the Malinowskian Feldarbeit is something very contained, and your conceptualization of von Humboldt is actually exactly the other way. It's about an open end travel and not of something contained. And I want to know if I understand that correctly.
Thank you again. I'll repeat what they said. Thank you again for the inspiring talk. And I'll follow up the previous question about the containment of Alexander von Humboldt. One of his main products of his work is the cartographic imagery that came out of his work in Berghaus's Atlas from that. And I think nothing could be more contained than the maps that were produced, especially with regards to that period of map making that had very little motion in it, very little arrows added in it, especially referring to movement of people. So in terms of botanical mapping, sometimes you saw some imagery that showed maps, that showed flows or movement, but when they depicted people, races, for example, came up in the later period of Humboldt, then it was completely territorialized, very discreet, very separated, and that comes in a slight contrast to the issue of movement, openness.
Okay. Yes, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. Perhaps I will start with the two questions. They are pretty close to each other, not only in space, but then come back to your question. Yes, the cartographic image is a very complex topic. The images or the cartographic representations you are addressing are made by Berghaus, included later in the Cosmos editions. But this is not Humboldt. And Humboldt introduced movement in cartographic forms of representation. For example, there is the first movement or the first map of movements is when figuring out how the edelmetalle, silver and gold is circulated on a global level. And then you may perhaps know that kind of cut through the Andes, where South America is looking like an island, yeah. And he is addressing plant geography. He's the founder of the discipline of plant geography in terms of cartographic representation as something that is migrational. So no plant is from a given spot Everything is moving. You have the volcanoes, they are moving. You have the plants, the animals represented there, and you have the people. It's very hard to see, but there is there are always explanations, so to speak, addressing different pictorial images. So in the plantations, in the down at the almost at the sea level, at the level of the oceans, you can see slaves, and the slaves are deported, and this is addressed. So everything in from the geological dimension, Humboldt was aware of the fact. He was not absolutely the first, and the theory of it came a little bit later with Alfred Wegener, but the continental drift, Humboldt was very aware of that, and he tried to describe that. And so everything from geology through botany and zoology to anthropology and the human being, everything is on the move in Humboldt, even in cartography. So, of course, if Humboldt would have had a laptop, he was the terror of all cartographers, yeah, because he continually changed things and wanted to introduce this. So, I'm sorry, your question was on, field research. So, it's fascinating to work on Alexander von Humboldt's manuscripts of his traveling, for example, through the Americas. And there you have a very clear and new conception of what field work is. So of course there is a kind of very, territorialized description of all the phenomena you can find, for example, in different altitudes on the side of a volcano, or everything he was able to collect at a given place, and he tried to do a really advanced research on that. So Alexander von Humboldt is considered as one of the founders of field research. It's a new period with Humboldt, but his writings are polylogic. It's not a single logic that is dominating the whole of it. It's like in the languages. He's going from one language to another and then back and forth continually. There's not a single point of view in the production of knowledge he is reducing the whole thing to. So, of course, he has modernized in that sense, territorializing scientific practices. But at a given level, he inscribes that in the different movements. So, for example, in the picture, of course, the picture as itself is not moving, but it is based on movement. You can see where the plants come from. You can see the volcanoes smoking. So. And the whole image, which is one of the most famous in 19th century sciences, it's only the Tree of Life by Darwin, who is better known. I'm not quite sure, but better known. At least perhaps not as a very complex image, but as something that stands for a given epistemological understanding of life. There you can see that it is inscribed in vectorial dimensions always. It's kind of obsession. Weltbewußtsein, for example, it looks like a term that is static, so the consciousness of the world. But he tries to understand in which sense the Weltbewußtsein has moved from the East, from Mesopotamia, through the Greek archipelago to Western Europe and then to the Americas. So it's very translatio studii, translatio imperii. So everything is on the move with Humboldt. And Todorov. The question was improvisation, right? So I think that could be, we could understand Todorov's thought or thinking in terms of power as a very successful for Europe, right? It's based, it's analyzing the expansion, the European expansion, and the reasons why the European expansion was so successful, right? But there is, there might be an underlying discourse that not only stretches the limits of la question de l'autre, so the different construction, the definition, and at the same time the elimination of the other, right? It's, this is in a sense the deeper consequences that Todorov is describing is not only the definition of others as others, but their elimination. But perhaps in this kind of logic, in this kind of construction of others, those who win will destroy themselves. And this is perhaps quite a given, a good moment to rethink that at a moment when we, when the fourth period, we could say, of accelerated globalization right now is coming to an end. This is not the end of history, but it's a good occasion, it's a good moment to rethink history in terms of a long-term globalization coming in the fourth period right now to an end, and allowing us in that sense as a kind of deacceleration. And when you are really quick, and when the velocity, or as Goethe puts it, luciferisch, velociferisch, so teuflisch schnell, so very quick, is deaccelerated, you feel the velocity. This is the moment when you feel it, when you deaccelerate. So perhaps in this historical moment we are living right now, it is a good moment to rethink what has so long dominated our thought, our epistemology, so la question de l'autre, and to try to develop different concepts. And sometimes it's quite good to look at the production of knowledge and perhaps of wisdom in that context, in the context of the 19th century travelers, or the production of a knowledge on the move, in order to see how we can reconstruct the future.